Howdy guys and gals, welcome back to the Social Regressive and part 4 in our Massive Optics series, talking about how to select the perfect rifle scope for you and your individual situation. And remember that everything that we talk about needs to be target-centric. We're thinking about getting that round on target at whatever distance that it's likely to be at. So keep that in mind. Your situation may be very different from somebody else's, so don't try to apply the two. Now today we're going to be talking about a kind of a, not really a controversial subject, but it's one that has a lot of confusion around it. And we're going to try to clear a lot of that up today. This is first focal plane versus second focal plane. And what that is it's just talking about where the reticle is. Remember that your reticle is whatever kind of lines, dots, little index vectors that you have when you look through the scope to indicate, you know, where you have kind of aligned the scope relative to where your rifle is shooting. And in here, there are a couple different places that we can put that reticle. Most of the scopes that you see out on the market are going to have the reticle right back here. It's going to be the last thing that is in kind of the lens sandwich before we get to the ocular lens back here. That's called second focal plane. This is where most of your kind of whitetail 3-9 scopes are going to have that crosshair reticle. And actually, I just happen to have a scope right here that I've removed the lens from the back. This is an old Simmons 8-point. I've taken the lens off so you can see the actual wire reticle on the inside. It's kind of neat to see the precision and beauty, even in an inexpensive scope like this one. But yeah, you can see the crosshair sitting right there, just out in the open, before it hits the ocular lens on the far end. The other place we can put our reticle is at the front of the erector tube in here, up near the turrets, and that's what we call first focal plane. We'll have the light coming in through the objective lens, and it's going to strike the reticle before it actually gets to the erector elements, the ones that actually flip the image, and whatever lenses we might have in here for zooming in and out on the image. And what that means is that the reticle is actually going to stretch and shrink at the same rate as whatever image is coming in through the objective right here. And here's what that actually looks like. These two have the same type of reticle, but you can see that one of them is kind of moving relative to your eye. It's staying true as far as the target goes. It's always measuring the same amount along with the target, and that is first focal plane. This other one is second focal plane, where the reticle is kind of staying true to your eye. It's not moving around, it's not stretching or shrinking, but it is changing its value relative to the object. And this is as we are zooming in and out using that zoom ring right here. The first type we'll take a look at is first focal plane, like this Falcon M18. Or the Horus Hover that we have right here. This is a 5-20. Both of these are going to have the reticle toward the front of the erector tube, so it's going to have the type that stretches and shrinks based on the magnification that we have right here. Now, this kind of setup only makes sense if you have a reticle that has some complication to it. It needs to have some extra lines or dots or whatever is going to be inside there so that you can measure things. And that's going to help you address windage and drop and be able to do actually ranging through the scope. You can figure out how far away your target is if you know its size by using some of these little dots and lines inside there. So say, for example, you know that your bullet at 300 yards is going to drop 1 milliradian. You can use one of the hash lines inside here, and instead of having to actually dial your turrets to make the adjustment for that shot, you can just use one of the lines inside there, hold up, and then you can make the hit at that distance. Same thing with windage. If you have your card and you know your ballistics for this, and you can kind of figure out what your environment's like, what kind of wind you're dealing with, then you can hold off a certain amount, and then you'll be able to account for the windage and make the proper hit. Now, there are some drawbacks to this. As you can imagine, this is very, very powerful. I love FFP for those reasons. This can actually be very, very quick on target with great precision, like with the hog hunt that I did a couple years ago. I was able to hit a running hog at 400 yards with the Bushnell HDMR2 and its Horus H59 reticle. I was able to use that very quickly. I didn't have time to dial my turrets in order to make that hit because, you know, the scope was actually sighted for 100 yards, but in order to hit a running animal at 400 yards, I had to hold up and I had to hold off, and I had to do it quickly. So I used that reticle to good effect to put that animal down, and it worked. It matches speed with precision very, very well. But like I mentioned, there are some drawbacks. First off, it is going to be more expensive overall. Some companies try to kind of get the prices about the same. If you have a similar reticle, similar setup, they might keep the prices the same, but for the most part, you're going to be paying extra for FFP. And there's a good reason for that. FFP uses a much smaller reticle. It has to be much smaller inside that erector tube, and usually it is that glass-edged reticle, so they have to be very, very precise in order to get a good image onto that glass and get that image to your eye. There's also probably going to be just a little bit more precision, a little bit more going on in that erector tube and your cam tube in order to make sure that everything lines up just right. Another drawback that's actually a strength is that the precision of the reticle and what it measures does not change with zoom. Now, like I say, that's a good thing and a bad thing. It kind of depends on what you want. If you want to be able to measure a bit more precisely down at some of your higher zooms, then it's not really going to change with the reticle inside here. Some of the modern FFP reticles have a lot more detail inside them, so it's easier to make very small measurements, but sometimes with a second focal plane reticle, if you zoom in past its kind of natural zoom state, like most of those scopes are going to be measuring true at 10x. If you zoom into 20x, for example, you may actually get double the precision. Just kind of depends on what you're after. We'll talk about SFP in a second and where you want it. But for the most part, if you have a dynamic situation, if you have an environment that may change very radically, and you want to be able to deal with things that are moving, FFP really is the way to go. Now for one of the other drawbacks that you really need to be thinking about, especially when you select your scope and whatever zoom ratio that it has. Remember that your zoom ratio is if you take your maximum magnification, like this 20 right here, this is a 5 to 20. If you take the 20, divide it by 5, this has a 4x zoom ratio. And that works out really well with an FFP reticle. That's kind of in that sweet spot. And here's why. If we had a 1 to 10, there are a couple companies that make a 10x zoom ratio scope. Like there's a March that they have some that go from, you know, maybe 1 to 10 or from 5 to 50. If you get into one of those scopes, then what's going to happen is all those little lines that you have etched in that reticle are going to zoom all the way from so incredibly small that you can't even really see them, especially against the messy background, to suddenly blowing up and it's the width of a telephone pole. You can hide any kind of target behind that. And so most of these scope manufacturers on the tactical side of things where you have first focal plane, they're trying very hard to nail this very precise little setup to get it just right. So you're not covering your target, you don't have super, super thick stadia that are getting in the way of everything, and that you don't also have ridiculously tiny lines that are useless when it actually comes to take a shot at lower magnification. So that's why we're going to have a lot of these scopes mostly hanging around somewhere between 4x zoom ratio up to, we have some at 8x, like this guy right here, US Optics TS8X. This has some extra tricks to make that happen. We'll talk about that just here in a second. I'll just put this to the side. But for the most part, for me, having looked through a bunch of these scopes, the practical usage of one of these tops out at about 6x. I want it between 4 and 6. Otherwise, I either lose the reticle on that low side, or it just gets ridiculously thick up on the high side. And most of the scopes that you see here are going to match that. So this is a 4x right here, the Bushnell Match Pro. We kind of have the same thing going on. This is a 5 to 20 right here with the US Optics TS20X. These guys have been pretty smart about setting this up here. And this is 4X as well, the Nikon FX1000 4 to 16. Now, the way that they can get away with this, the US Optics TS8X, is that they kind of have two different sections of the reticle. They have one that's a little bit finer. You have the lines for making a hit at some of the longer distances. This is an AR style scope, an LPVO. This is one that you would want to put on your AR. But if you want to make precise shots, you can use those lines that are a little bit thinner. And then you also have that great big horseshoe that's thicker, and the whole thing can illuminate. So that's how they can get away with it. And yes, it does work. I like this scope a lot. They were pretty smart about setting up the reticle the way that they did. Now for SFP, second focal plane, let's pick this guy right here. This is a Bushnell AR Optics. This scope has a pretty wide zoom range, 4.5 to 18, and it has a cool little throw lever that you can use to quickly get from one to the next. Great tricks like side parallax adjustment, and it has a second focal plane reticle that actually is a little bit on the complicated side. It isn't just a crosshair. This is a bullet drop compensating reticle that they call drop zone. All the different manufacturers have their own names for a BDC or bullet drop compensating reticle. And what that means is that if you line the dots up just right, say you have your dot that you've designated for 200 yards, you can hold up on that dot and then you can make your hit. This depends on your ballistics, and working through the Bushnell app, you can figure out what zoom is going to be just right for you. Because remember that the reticle does not change its size relative to your eye, but as you zoom this around, its size is going to change radically relative to your target. So as you zoom in on your target, the reticle here has not changed, but it has gotten more precise. It's seeing a smaller value. So if you know on your ballistics drop chart that you need, say, a milliradian to make a hit at that 300 yards again, you can't really count on being able to zoom in and out and be able to make that hit. There's going to be one sweet spot that you figure out with this bullet drop compensator, and you're going to leave it there. And then with that correct dot, that 300 yard dot, then you'll be able to make the hit. So for the most part, this is a scope that you're gonna kinda lock and leave, unless you get into some extreme circumstances where maybe you're dealing with targets that are really close up, then you can just dial that all the way back and maybe just use the crosshair in the middle to make that hit. So yeah, second focal plane, you can actually get into greater precision. Like I mentioned, we were talking about FFP, as you zoom in, you can actually change the precision of what your reticle is measuring. But for the most part, it is going to be slower, or you might end up using your scope at kind of a fixed power, especially if you have one of the more complicated reticles. To put it another way, a second focal plane reticle can actually do anything that the first focal plane reticles can do, but it might require some translation based on whatever zoom that you have going on. Now let's talk about some of the positives of this. Now first off, the reticle is going to be relatively crisp. You're not going through as many glass elements, so if there is a little bit of funkiness going on with some of your glass, maybe just a little bit of dispersion or something, you're not gonna get it with that second focal plane reticle. It's gonna show up very crisp to the eyeball. So like your whitetail scope usually has a very crisp crosshair, very easy to see. And one of the cool things that folks can do is they can set up this reticle at exactly the fineness or thickness that they want. It doesn't matter really how thick it is relative to the target, unless you do want to get some very specific measurements going on. But you can kind of pick one that's perfect for the eye instead. So if you don't want to risk losing your crosshair when you're on a very messy background, like a whole lot of brush in the background, maybe you're in the woods and everything's just very stark, sometimes you can actually lose an FFP reticle, like we mentioned. But an SFP one is usually going to stay very crisp and very clean compared to the background. Second focal plane scopes can be a little bit simpler, a little less fiddly, and they can have that larger reticle, which is easier to make. So for the most part, you will be paying less, even glass for glass, with an SFP scope. If you're the kind of guy that wants a simpler reticle, you want to be able to maybe, slam that to one spot and just leave it, you want to keep things a little easier, then SFP might be for you. Also, for a lot of target shooters, there's a good reason to go that direction. There are certain target scopes that are left at SFP or even fixed magnification with an SFP reticle for very good reasons. First off, you can, with a fixed power scope like this one, the SWFASS, you can get a much cleaner image because there's just less going on inside there, and you can also get more adjustment. So this can reduce complexity, perhaps boost the amount of light that comes to your eye, and you can get more resolution overall, even with kind of a smaller objective lens. And you can end up with a very good, powerful system. This does have a reticle right back here in that SFP position. And yeah, there are some very high-end scopes for specific matches, like F-class, for example. That reticle is set up precisely for F-class to be able to kind of bracket different spots based on windage on the target. And you can get into some pretty high-end SFP stuff. So if you have a very specific use, you might take a look at some of these. In a shocking turn of events, there actually are scopes that have both reticles at the same time, FFP and SFP. And this is getting to that issue that I was talking about before with FFP scopes, one of their drawbacks. You kind of have that limited zoom ratio where you're kind of stuck with, you know, maybe 4x to 6x, kind of the sweet spot. Otherwise, you start losing the reticle details down at the low end. It just all just kind of starts disappearing and you can't read numbers anymore. And when you zoom in, you get this really thick line. Well, Valdata dealt with this when they made a 1 to 10x scope, which was going to be completely unusable with its massive zoom ratio. Well, what they did is they added a red dot. It's actually kind of an amber dot, I think, that is second focal plane and has a fixed size. So that if you're using that scope at very close range, you're not using the reticle anymore, you're just kind of slamming it into 1x and you're just using the dot. And then if you are zooming in farther, you can have a little bit thinner stadia and you can make your more precise shots when you're zoomed all the way into 10x. And there are some others that have tried this out as well. Maybe not a dot, but maybe they've had a horseshoe or something else that can be kind of a large thing to look at when you're zoomed way out. In the final analysis, which should you choose? First focal plane or second focal plane? There is going to be an element of personal taste here. You may prefer to have something that's always a fixed width, in which case you're going to like second focal plane. But then there are also personal limitations. If your eyesight isn't what it used to be, you may prefer not to be squinting at tiny little lines when you're zoomed out. You may prefer to have a reticle that's always the same no matter what zoom you're at, and you may prefer that second focal plane as well. Also, if you're going to be dealing with paper and steel, second focal plane is a great choice. Anything that's going to be a bit more stationary. Like I said, this 8.5 to 25 power scope that right here, second focal plane, I've used this to kill most of my prairie dogs. And prairie dogs, yes, they're mobile, but for the most part, when you take the shot, they're stationary. They just kind of wander over, stand there, and you take your shot. And some animals are going to be like that. However, if you are going to be in more dynamic situations and more dangerous situations, I highly recommend first focal plane. And this is something that I can bear out in my own testing. Hunting hogs, hunting animals that move much more quickly, like say coyotes, FFP makes a whole lot of sense. Yes, you may have some difficulties with, you know, the stadia changing size as you zoom in and out, but it is well worth the trade when it comes time to take a shot on a moving animal and where things may be very different in terms of distance. Thanks a lot for watching, you guys. Make sure that you like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. And just watch for the new videos that are coming out. This is part 4 of a 15-part series, and we have a whole lot more to talk about. I've got my notes right over here on my phone, and we're going to get into a whole lot of stuff. I hope you found this useful. If you did, please leave a comment. And if I missed something, let me know. Put your own comments down below. If you differ, you know, on your opinion of things, put it down there. Let's get the conversation started. And yeah, be watching for the new stuff as it comes out. Thank you to everybody that makes videos like these possible. Like, we actually have a bunch of manufacturers that have loaned or donated scopes that we're looking at here today. And thank you to patrons of the Destructive Arts that have provided lights and some of the scope rings and mounts, audio gear. If anybody else wants to chip in a buck or two a month, I'll put a link around here. At the 338 Lapua Magnum level, we have Tyler, we have Sportsman's Guide, and Stan and Mary. And then at the 300 Win Mag level, we have Howard, Mr. No Name, Peter, and Joseph Davis. And then, yeah, we just have a whole lot of other guys that are chipping in a buck or two a month to keep content like this coming. I hope it's been helpful, and I'll see you in the next video. Thanks for watching. If you liked this video, be sure to like, share, and most importantly, subscribe. Even if you didn't like this particular content, go ahead and subscribe. There's probably something coming that's more up your alley. Check out this playlist right here. This is going to have videos in a similar vein to what you just watched. These two videos we cherry-picked for you. And finally, The Social Regressive is on Patreon. So you can become a patron of the Destructive Arts and earn some goodies while helping us to provide high-quality videos just by kicking us a few bucks a month. Thanks a bunch for your patronage.